On this Minute of the Apes, we joke about the Friday podcast, nothing happening the actual minute, and guess what? That happens again. So Sean would be making fart noises the entire time.
They greenlit the sequel without a story in mind. They just wanted to equal an unexpected gold mine.
And they said, oh no, as Heston said, I got to go. These are just some of the facts you ought to know as we go.
Beneath the Minute of the Apes. Beneath the Minute of the Apes. Beneath the Minute of the Apes.
Hello and welcome to Minute of the Apes, the daily podcast where we break down every minute of the Planet of the Apes one minute at a time. I'm Todd. That was Sean farting, and Richard is the good one across the table.
It's Fartin'
Hi, guys.
Fridays.
It's Friday.
Fartin' Fridays.
Fartin' Fridays.
It's Friday. It's a Fartin' Friday.
So, Fartin' Friday, we are up to minute 15. Sean, why don't you tell us what's going on in this minute?
All right, we're going to start minute 15 with Taylor staring at the crevice in the earth, and ends with Nova looking around with a confused look on her face.
All right, let's roll our clip.
Here. A minute ago, that wasn't here. I'm not the only one. She sees it too. Listen now. If you lose me, me, and try to find Zira. Remember, Zira. Go find Zira. Zira.
All right, as of minute 15, we've got 3 living humans, 4 dead, 1 dead ape, a shrewdness of apes, and a gaggle of humans.
So we get a moment where we actually kind of actually see the crevice, and we see the rock kind of jutter this way away
right.
from them.
Yeah.
And there's still these, because they're actually not physically where this is happening. The only way we can convey the emotion of this crevice opening up is to continue to do these frantic shots on Taylor and Nova where they're reacting to something. We get maybe the top of the horse and maybe part of Nova's wig, but it's mostly just this kind of herky jerky movement around to convey that they're reacting to something because we can't physically show them there except for in that split diopter thing.
And I
diopter,
agree with you,
you son of a bitch.
what I thought at that point was Their go-to shot is that close-up, zoomy, handheld rocking shot. I would have loved to have seen something low angle up on the horse rearing back, you know, just to show, again, being in the moment. But it was weird. It's the one thing about that great shot. It looks fantastic as the earth splits open, but I don't ever feel like they're there. The earth is going, and that horse is just kind of
it's not rocking around or anything. It's just rearing up.
Yeah. And so if they had cut to a low shot of the horse, woo, and if the camera's rocking, I get that sensation. But it's kind of, for as great as that effect is, it's poorly done in the reaction shots.
Well, then in 5 seconds into this minute, all of a sudden, the crevice is open, but we're now someplace else. We're not near that crevice. They're on the horse, and they're just kind of sitting calmly in what now appears to be the top of a canyon.
And I put this as a note. So I'm Taylor. I was on a hilltop or something, and then fire cut me off. Then I'm on a plane, and then there's lightning, and then there's an earthquake, and all of a sudden there's a wall behind me. What the hell is going on? This to me doesn't – at this point now, it doesn't feel like bad editing. It feels like you're literally supposed to be confused, that the environment is changing around
all
him
right.
constantly.
Okay.
And to be fair, I think that is what they want. I think that they are supposed to feel like, what the hell is happening?
Yeah.
I'm not even in control of my surroundings. That's the desired effect. It's not handled very well because, to what Richard's saying, it's, wait, they were here, they were here, they're here.
I think I had the benefit of watching minute by minute and analyzing minute. I can see if you're watching it and this is happening in 60 seconds, 120 seconds, what the hell is going on?
And as I've mentioned, this is filmed at Red Rock Canyon State Park. That's along Highway 14 in California, in case you want to get down there and look. I found that trivial note and I thought I couldn't resist it, but I don't know what that park looks like. I don't know if they don't have a lot of these different faces to shoot around.
Yeah, there's only so many different environments you can shoot in.
But at the same time, at that point, should that... I don't care how close it is and how much money you're going to save, should that not be... we can't shoot there. It doesn't offer us what we need. Because a lot of this
did
doesn't make sense.
Did the script say anything about the environments or anything?
Did
they
say
as Richard, that?
As Richard looks at that, so we go from the rocky face with the burning, we go to the weird, we're on a salt plain with lightning, to the earth opening, and the next shot we get is they're standing on rosy sand with a yellow rock face in front of them.
Yeah.
The rock doesn't match the environment, but suddenly they're there, and they're right in front of this massive rock face. Like, mm-hmm. if you saw that mountain, there'd be no doubt you're
as
upon
if,
it.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm staring at the front of the store now, and I turn around, I wouldn't expect there to be a mountain behind me. But that's right. Basically the equivalent of this. They've been cut off. They turn around, and the direction they came from is a totally new environment.
Right.
I cannot tell you without spoiling.
Okay. Well, then, there you go. So it's actually noted in the script stuff about it? Okay. It was a deliberate choice?
No. The wall of fire exists, but what they see after that is not this moment with the canyon and the crevice.
I would like to read those when we're done.
Sure.
All right.
So we've talked, Taylor does
agree that the wall is new. So.
So we've talked a lot about how the production of they did that. And this is pretty obvious when they get to this rosy sand with this yellow rock face. That's a matte painting where they've done it through, because as they ride closer to the wall, to me, you can almost see that if they were to go any closer, their heads would be cut off.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a pretty bad matte painting.
I mean, it'd be hard to imagine getting, in reality, this horse and these two actors on the top of that kind of a cliff canyon,
right,
with the giant crevice kind of in front of them, and then like the rocky wall behind them. I mean, that would tire like cranes and helicopters just to kind of prop them up there. So
if you're going to do these weird juxtapositions of here's flame, here's lightning, here's earth opening, and you're going to use a matte painting, why not do suddenly that the horse is standing on this one little spire in the middle of a canyon, and it's up there and they're all
stuck. Yeah.
That would, to me, that visually would have at least been
more shocking.
Yeah.
More surprising.
You're going from one end of the spectrum to the other. They've just done these weird things where they're popping things in.
Yeah.
Well, and we spend this minute with Nova in particular looking to the left and Taylor glancing to the left, but then kind of largely looking forward to his right, as if they're seeing something that they can't visually show us. They're letting the actors kind of convey this unusual situation they're in.
Because there's only so much they can do that.
But the last scene when they were kind of like jerking around to all the movements and you just tied on them moving around. What was it, the Bourne Identity movies where they used the shaky cam kind of thing?
Yeah,
they're still doing these really, really tight shots on Nova and Taylor, kind of whipping their heads around, looking confused, not knowing what's going on. I mean, it's almost a whole minute of that, really.
Yeah.
And isn't this the point also where he comments on the rock face and she sees it too? And he starts
talking to her again, he says, understand him.
A minute ago, that wasn't there. And he looks at, Nova looks at him.
Right.
And that's who goes, I'm not the only one. She sees it too.
Yeah. He's doing his internal monologue outside.
I think that Taylor actually was, in his reality, was the star of the Moses film as well, because he's acting like Moses on horseback. She sees it. Oh, what about this? Hey,
wait, there's a wall of flame. Where's the burning bush?
Well, but as he kind of looks at her, looks to the right, kind of looks down. She's kind of reacting to him a little bit, but she still keeps looking to the right or left. And I'm like, what is she looking at? Like, why
is
she
farting?
She's seeing something that I don't quite
get.
She's
only the director telling her, stop looking over here.
And then they do this awesome shot of him dismounting the horse, but we still haven't gone out of the kind of tight on the two of them. So you just see his giant foot come into his frame for like half a second as he kicks over the horse. So, he's been barefoot this entire time. That's got to suck.
There's actually a shot in that where you can see he's got back on his little adhesive feety things that they made for him in the first film. In one of the wide shots, you can literally see it's glistening on the bottom of his foot. So you can see it.
His special foot protection.
So Richard just pulls up the shot where he's now on the ground. He's pointing back up to her. He, at this point, says, if you lose me.
Mm-hmm. Again, talking to her like she understands what he's saying.
Listen now, Miss.
He's been trying to teach his name and her name. Now he's giving her complex instructions of what to do.
So he says, if you lose me, and his instructions are going to be, should something happen, we get separated, find Zira.
Again, does she know that name? He's been doing Taylor.
She doesn't know any of this, but what I hate even more is at that point, all tension is gone because he's now set it up. Oh, there's
something
is going
to happen to me.
And now I'm thinking it.
Right. True. Yeah.
It's that moment where I don't even worry about him. You know, if you want to imply that, have her reach for him and go, no, don't leave me. And he goes, it's okay. If anything happens, find Zira. That's how you do that. You don't say, if you lose me. It's, oh my God, when I heard that, I was like,
which means when you lose.
Yes.
I don't know how to talk about this without talking about
it's
too
hard.
Terribly much going forward.
Right.
Right. But in this moment, why would he send her back to Zira, knowing Zira was now, well, I guess maybe safe, but she's still an animal psychologist under the guise of Zaius.
Yeah, from his
point. I wouldn't send Zira back.
I can see
to,
that from his
to,
well, I guess because he tongued her on the beach. He thought, you know.
She But I don't know why he would send her back to Zira. Unless it's just something that he knows. But, I mean, she'd be in prison the rest of her life. Maybe Zira would set her up with a knight's mate. I don't know.
Well, from all we know of Taylor's last interaction with Zira, he was riding off. They thought they were going to be clear of all the charges of everything. He doesn't know that as soon as he left, you know,
Cornelius
said,
up.
I'm getting locked up and, you know,
yeah,
Dr.
but that's
Zaius
according
said,
to what they said in the last film. And this for when we've eradicated this part.
Well, no, they cut it down to not show us that. That doesn't mean it happened because it happened in the first movie.
Okay.
But there's a lot of, you know, the Go Find Zira, there's a lot of stuff that it's kind of hard that we could talk about, but we can't talk about future minutes. Like, there's a lot of little small things and details and saying, go find Zira.
Well, as long as he says Zira a whole lot, that means she'll understand it, right?
But
well,
she does, when he says, try to find Zira, remember Zira, go find Zira, 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 Zira. She is holding onto her dog tags and touching them, kind of, I mean, it's...
But then he again confuses her because he equates himself in that very scene to his dog tags again. He points and...
But
at them.
Did,
and she's she all she can think is what the f*** her dog tag.
I don't want these butt things.
I mean, she probably heard Zira being called Zira, but he's really relying upon a lot of her to remember.
Yeah, again,
that is a name that person is.
And that's what I'm saying. If he's literally still teaching his name and her name to him or to her, why does he assume she will remember Zira's name?
I know.
Okay, but let's imagine this. Let's strip it away to she's a simpleton.
Right.
She doesn't understand if anything happens to me, but he's at least put a nugget in her head, Zira.
Okay.
And fair. At that point, fair. When he's gone, Zira.
Zira was
he said he's Zira. You know, whatever her Zira. You know, she's hearing that.
Whatever her
that.
Nell language is.
Whatever it is that she does to converse with herself internal, she still hears Zira.
If we are to assume from this minute that this moment happens, he says something about if you lose me, because I don't know why he would suddenly lose her in this giant canyon. If you lose me, go find Zira. And we remember flashing back to her with Brent. I don't think she's doing it.
No, it would have been. No,
I think she's just riding the horse.
Yeah, she's just ambling.
She's just moving around. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool.
If they wanted to keep a theme going, whenever he said Zira, Zira, they should have had a flash cut to Zira. Just like whenever Taylor,
that's true. That's
Taylor,
true.
Taylor,
yeah.
I remember Taylor. Ding. That name makes sense to me, and I'm flashing back.
Oh, God, please.
Zira, Zira, just a quick flash of Zira so that you see that she's recognizing what he's saying.
Please tell me
if
this entire movie is not going
to
be shots of Nova remembering things. What?
And then it cuts back to Nova, and Nova's going,
by the end of it,
Cornelius.
We're all exhausted. It's like, stop!
And then it's Cornelius going, Zaius, Zaius. And then that loops around to Taylor, Taylor. And then we're just stuck in a loop for a whole movie.
A little bit of an aside to this. There were moments where they would flash on characters and the score would kind of pop in for a moment or two. And it reminded me of that SNL skit, The Californians,
yeah.
Where they would linger on a cliffhanger, da-na-na-na-na. Da na 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 na, like there were
everybody,
moments.
The
there
dramatic
moments
the, looks.
Yeah, exactly. There were moments where I was like, "That's what some of the score felt like."
Well,
the
score is much more pedestrian than what we had in the first.
Yeah.
Oh, for
it's,
sure.
I don't want to put down the gentleman that stepped in after Mr. Goldsmith, but
You can't live up to that. That's pretty tough. But like you said, you know what? Fridays, they're so slow that we're actually bitching about the composer right now.